So this is a pre-Civil War movie set in the Old West, correct?
Nebraska territory.
All right, and it's based on a novel by Glendon Swartout that your producer, Michael Fitzgerald, brought to you. What made you respond to this material?
Michael wanted to know if I thought there was a good movie in it, and after reading it, I said, well, there certainly is. Well, I'm sure we could make a screenplay that had some originality to it out of this material.
And the character played, it's a feminist take on the West, on the Old West. It reminds me, if it's okay to say this, it reminds me a little bit of Unforgiven in that sense, that you're dealing with the story from the point of view of the women in the story. Is that part of what appealed to both of you about this material?
The women are at the heart of the story. I thought that was part of the originality that we could bring to the screenplay.
First of all, it's hard to find a movie with one great female lead, let alone a nice handful of them. So I jumped at the opportunity.
And were you supposed to be able to ride a horse in order to do this part?
Yes, it was actually one of the first questions you would ask me. Do you have any experience on a horse? And, you know, usually I just kind of lie and go, yeah, and then go figure it out.
Yeah.
But I knew that you would still allow me to be a part of the movie, being honest and just get me some good people to show me what I was doing. And how to figure it out. But I know that was one of the things you said, you have to really be believable, so let's figure this out.
And that was a wonderful contribution that you made other than your impeccable performance. She worked every day at something that she really didn't know a lot about, and thank you for not lying. But she worked all day long every day at riding horses and driving a wagon. By the time it was over, she could take all the tack off of a team of mules and put it back on very quickly. And she got pretty handy with that horse. There came a time when she would take off between takes, and I'd have to send a wrangler with her with a radio on his belt, because I didn't want anything to happen to her. I want to make sure she got back.
Yeah, the wranglers are supposed to be there to rally the horses, but they became rallying me.
I was a little nervous about the scene where you were twirling around and around. That looked really a little dicey to me.
Well, there was a stunt that I had to try and figure out. And the interesting thing is, they're not going to put me on a dangerous horse, so the horse couldn't have been more docile. It really needed a good, like, elbowing. So I was having to elbow it at the same time I'm looking like I'm having a hard time getting on it. And I think it was one of those moments when we were, you know, losing the light and we had to hurry up and get it. Do you remember that day?
I remember it very well.
And the camera was about from here. I was in the camera was right at the edge of the stage here. And I think we had a couple takes to try and get it. And thankfully I didn't realize how dangerous it could have been if that horse just decided, you know, with one of my too hard of an elbows to go a little bit further. Thankfully it didn't end like that. And you had a great people surrounding me and, to help me figure out how to do all of that stuff. So
that was a good movie horse. It really was.
So you have a really good cinematographer on this, Rodrigo Prieto, and it's one of the most beautiful movies I've seen in recent years. It's really quite stunning. And
thank you.
I agree.
And you shot it in widescreen. And it's just, tell me why that was the way you wanted to go.
Widescreen. Well, it was the perfect aspect ratio for a country that's essentially minimalist in its design. There's heaven, there's earth, and the difference between is a horizontal line. So that's a good aspect ratio for this story.
So you've been giving some interviews about this, and you seem to be wanting to distance yourself from the idea of calling this a Western. And I wondered if you would explain why this is or is not a Western. It's more of a classic Western than some of the genre Westerns that have been made in recent years.
Oh, I don't have any issue with the language. I don't think there's much to it. There's not much to learn. To me, if you call a movie a Western, that means it has a horse or two and some big hats.
Someone falling out of a window, a two-story window.
That's what is it?
Burning
Western
house.
Were you trying to make it look different from other Westerns, or were you trying to tell the story in a particularly specific way?
No, I didn't. I didn't want to make a movie that was anti any other movie. We wanted to shoot that country as beautifully as we possibly could and get our story told. We had some good help.
Now, Swartout has made a number of his novels. He's sort of like Larry McMurtry. He's had a number of films made. The Shootist is one. Where the Boys Are is another. What is it about his storytelling, you think, that lends itself to the movie so well?
Oh, I think the idea of making this movie about a journey of women going east instead of west is just overall a pretty good construct. You know, I don't think it's a particularly good novel, actually, but it's the idea is much more cinematic than it is literary.
I was born in Nebraska. All my family's from Iowa. They're sitting here in the audience. And so I come from a generation of farmers, and I feel like this is in my marrow. But I think what I really loved about it, and what I love about going even back to Iowa now, is there's something I feel that we're lacking in the world today, which are manners and values and morals. And to me, Mary B. Cuddy is such a shining example of those things. And she does the right thing because it's just that. It's the right thing. It's not because she wants to be pat on the back. And I really love that. So I can't speak to really exactly your question about the structure, but for me, I can say why I came on board. And I mean, other than wanting to work with the great Tommy Lee Jones and finding the script to be poetic, it was a poem in the way it was written. And when we were actually filming, something that I loved that Tommy Lee did was he would say, I added that just now. He would say, you added the or and it's not there. So let's be really specific to the dialogue, and because there's a rhythm to it. And even as specifically as the last woman that I picked up who was tied to the bedpost, she was going, tha, 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 tha. And Tommy Lee walked in, and I think it was her first day of filming, and he said, there's six thas, and you said eight. But the specificity in which he directs is so wonderful to be under that direction, because there is a musicality to the movie. And when you see it, you see that. And I've never thought about it like that, even though I saw it as a poem, that if you change any one word, it changes the structure of the scene.
The movie also has an amazing score by Marco Beltrami.
Oh, yeah.
Talk about some of the innovations that you brought to the music of the movie and how much you wanted it to be part of nature.
Marco is a good thinker musically, and we encourage that because can't pay him a lot of money. But we can offer him a chance to be as original as he wants to be, or can be. As an example, if you'll just remember the last few minutes of the score that played over the credits, it sounds very strange. It's played by an instrument that we invented, that we created. We found an old upright piano in the basement of a church somewhere. It was old, beaten up. Barely in tune, and we ran some cables off the soundboard over 250 feet of an arroyo or draw, a little canyon like that, up to a 12,500-gallon steel water tank, and we put the microphone inside the water tank, and we put stops on the strings. So the wind would play the piano.
Wow.
And you could move those stops back and forth. You could also play the piano on the keyboard. And you could also take a cellist's bow and scrape those strings. But what you're finally doing is you're turning the wind, which is a big deal in New Mexico and certainly in Nebraska on all the grasslands.
It becomes a season.
Wind is so in the important. So the world became a musical instrument. And that's the kind of thing that Marco and I like to do together. And he certainly has all of the opportunity, all the resources we can put before him to do such things. He's invited to do that kind of thinking. First question for Marco, of course, would be, why don't you just use a computer and and just do that digitally? Well, it's really not the same. When you come back for the second viewing, and I encourage everybody to do that, because this movie was built to get better every time you see it, listen for that wind piano. We've invented a few musical instruments.
You also shot the film on 35 as opposed to digital. Why did you do that?
Well, we tested six cameras, or eight. We tested eight, and I just could not find a digital camera that could shoot those great big wide exteriors as well as that old workhorse built by Aeroflex with some very high speed Japanese film stock. But we needed some help and some backup for low light conditions. And I'd shot before with Sony's F-35. They have a new one called F-65. There's not a lot of difference between the two, but this thing can see in the dark. And it's the only example that I've ever seen of successful day for night photography. I can always see when a film is trying to pass off day for night. It's always takes me out of the movie. It's always ugly. But we got away with it with that. And so the F-35 was very, very useful to us, but it wasn't our main, let's say, artistic instrument.
One of the things that I appreciated about the craftsmanship of this movie is that we've come to a point in time where there really aren't that many craftspeople in the movie business who still remember the Old West, who were part of it, who were real cowboys. And you grew up in Texas, and you have a ranch, and your family goes back many generations. You have a relationship with the Old West yourself, correct?
Well, it's, it's the New West. Pretty modern for us right now.
But people know how, you know how to use a rope. You know how to function.
Yeah, we're in the horse and the cattle business. We're in the horse and cattle business. We work at it every day. I can't be there every day, but the ranches are well organized.
And if he needs help, I can plow his fields.
No, always got Hilary right here.
Talk about the plowing, Hilary. That was insane.
Well, it's interesting. Actually, just driving one mule as you walk behind it is an interesting task. You add the two, that's interesting. So I learned to do that first. And then we put a railroad tie behind it and I would pull that and learn how to do that. And then we added the plow. And a plow with one wheel, I had to put all my weight on it to actually get it to plow while steering the plow and the mules and get it to go in a straight line. It might have looked easy, but it was really challenging.
Backbreaking work.
Yeah, I have to say I have a lot of a newfound respect. One of the greatest things I think about stepping into someone else's shoes in this type of way is understanding what it's like for farmers. They're in better shape than any bodybuilder any day.